But you can say أخشى من أسد. أخشى means to have reverence. And خشى is another word which people use for the meaning of خوف, but خشى means something that's in front of you right now. And you know its quality so well, you have such a significant cognition of the reality of that thing's attributes that you're in awe of it. You're in reverence to it. That's why Allah says about the ulama, يَخَافُونَ اللَّهَ يَخْشَوْنَ اللَّهَ. Does Allah say that the scholars, they fear Allah khawf? Or does Allah, when He talks about the people who have knowledge in the Quran, He uses the word khasha. He uses the word khasha. Because the scholar, the real scholar, is the one who knows who. Who knows Allah as though Allah is in front of him. So Allah used the word khasha for the ulama. See the beauty of the Quran? لَنَّ صِحَةُ الْمَعْرِفَةِ تُفِيدْهَا هَذِهِ الْخَشَةِ That sincere ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as though they know him. That's why they're called awliya'ullah. The friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As though they know him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Those who know Allah, those who are close to Allah, they have no fear, no grief. But at the same time in Surah Al-Fatir, Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَةِ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ. But at the same time, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ. So Allah says, those awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have no fear, nor grief. But then He describes those righteous people. In another verse, He says, those people who know Allah, they're the only ones who have this reverence for Him. Why? Because they know Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who know Him, inshaAllah. Amen. Through His tawheed and His af'al and asma and so on. Number two is the meaning according to the Sharia. Imam al-Qushayri, rahimahullah, in his Risalah, Risalah al-Qushayriya, he says, Al-Khawf means to fear the possibility that Allah will punish you in the future. In this life or in the next life. And you khaf that he fears the iqab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, imma fi dunya wa imma fi al-akhir. Whether in this life or the hereafter. Another scholar, he said something beautiful. He said, to fear Allah means not to attribute to yourself in the future or tomorrow. Meaning that you live now. You don't know what's promised to you, so you live with this urgency. There are different types of fear mentioned in the Quran itself. But one scholar from Dimashq, he said something beautiful about al-khawf also. He said, "Sirajul qalb." He said that fearing Allah is the torch of the heart. Like how you go down a dark cave with a torch so you can see everything. So he said, "Al-khawf min Allah sirajul qalb. Yubsiru bihi ma fihi min ash-sharri wal-khayr." He said that is a torch in your heart. With it that you see what's in your heart from evil and goodness. In the Quran, we see the purpose of this khawf, to understand the meaning of al-khawf, illustrated in different ways. And it's very important, brothers and sisters, to go to the Quran, to go back to the Quran to understand the meaning of words, to understand the meaning of words. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in Surah Ma'idah that someone who has this fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is somebody who's going to stay away from sin and aggression. Stay away from sin and aggression. So I have the story of Habil and Qabil, the two sons of Adam, when his brother said to him, قَالَ لَأَقَتُلَنَّكَ. He said, I'm going to kill you. قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Then his brother said to him, Habil, he said, Allah will only accept the deeds of the righteous people. لَإِنْ بَسَطْتَ إِلَيَّ يَدَكَ لِتَقْتُلَنِي مَا أَنَا بِبَاسِطٍ يَدِي إِلَيْكَ لِأَقَتُلَكَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Another riwayah, يَدِيَ. In this riwayah, شُعْبَةَ يَدِي. Allah says that He said to His brother, if you extend your hand to kill me, I will not extend my hand and reciprocate this evil. Why? إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Because I fear Allah. I fear Allah. Also we have the hadith of the young man, or a young woman also, who will be inshaAllah, from one of those seven people that, who will be in the shade of Allah when there's no shade. Now you're still, except the shade of Allah. Now you're still young, because young is till 40, alhamdulillah. Without Botox. We have Iman tax. Qalb tax. Tazkiyah tax. So now as a young person, you have an opportunity, inshallah, to be from these seven people, in the shade of Allah, in the day when there's no shade but the shade of Allah. Ya salam. So one of those seven people, the Prophet said, Shab nasha fi ibadati Allah, is the young person who used his youth for Allah. But also he mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, another person who, a beautiful woman, is going to call him to something forbidden. And he's going to say to her, Inni akhafu Allah, I fear Allah. I fear Allah. Al-Qadi Iyad rahimahullah al-Mariki, he mentioned about this hadith something nice. He said, it's probable that he said, Inni akhafu Allah to the girl. And by Allah, I had one friend, mashallah, from Syria, mashallah. He has a clothing store in Kuwait. Good buddy of mine. So he told me one time I traveled to one country. And I went into the hotel that night, and suddenly somebody knocked on my door. I opened the door, it was a woman with no clothes on. And she said, she wasn't talking about Botox. So she said something to him, and he said, I'm so happy. I said, oh man, what happened, man? He said, no, I'm so happy. I said, well, I said, I told her, Inni akhafu Allah. I told her, I fear Allah. So I hope I will be from those seven shaded under the shade of Allah when there's no shade but the shade of Allah. SubhanAllah. Then, unfortunately, he got a phone call and they said, what's wrong with you? All of the Muslim customers, they're like this. SubhanAllah. Non-Muslim country, man. But he said, Alhamdulillah, I was able to say, Inni akhafu Allah. And I hope Allah will make me, inshallah, from those people who will be under his shade on a day when there's no shade but his shade. We ask Allah also to make us from those people, inshallah. So Al-Iyad, he said something beautiful. He said, it's possible that this man, he said it to the woman, I fear Allah. Or he said, also it's possible because the power of fearing Allah, the strength of fearing Allah, the impact that fearing Allah has on the iman of a person, that actually he said it to who? To himself. In his heart, he said to himself, Ittaqillah. And you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he would shake himself like an alarm clock to remind himself of his responsibility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next type of khawf is the khawf of the righteous people. The fear of Allah, which we find from those people who might not be scholars, but they have religiosity. Religiosity. And that's the fear of the permissible. In fearing that permissible act might lead me to the forbidden. So this person, not only do they stay away from the haram, they stay away from what? The halal. Fearing what? That they might fall into the haram. La ilaha illallah. So one scholar said, the heart which has fear of Allah in it will not speak about those things which don't concern it. That person who has that fear of Allah in his heart. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in a sound hadith, man husna al-islami mar'i tarkahu ma la ya'ni. The best of one's Islam is to leave what doesn't concern him. It's not his business. He doesn't get involved. So one of the signs that someone doesn't have this khawf is they're always in folks' business. Yeah? Because they don't fear falling into something forbidden by always talking about people and lenders or something. Number two, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave us this example in a sound hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashir. Radiallahu anhu, al-Nu'man, he related this hadith when he was about 8 years old. He heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet said, indeed the permissible is clear and the forbidden is clear, and between them are areas or issues which most people don't know about. Meaning most people don't know their rulings. The rulings of those things. Are they halal? Are they haram? Is it disliked? And so on. He said, so the one who avoids those doubtful issues, فَقَدْ إِسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِي, then he protected his deen and his honor. Two maqasid from the objectives of sharia is religion and honor. So he protected those two maqasid. So the ulama said also this fell into this type of issue. Something that's permissible, but the scholars differed over it. Those who said it's haram, some said it's halal. This type of person who reached this maqam of khawf, he will leave the rukhsa. He will leave that opinion that says you can do it, it's halal, to save his deen or to save her deen. Number three is the fearing of Allah himself. Al-khawf min Allah. To fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And maybe somebody, if you look in the Quran, you find some interesting verses. Allah says, وَيُحَذِّرُكُمْ اللَّهُ نَفْسَهُ. Allah warns you of himself. Allah warns you of himself. إِنَّ بَطَشَ رَبِّكَ لَشَدِيدٌ. The punishment of Allah is severe. How many of you are ready to stand in front of Allah right now? How many of us ready to stand in front of Allah and answer for our lives? So that feeling you have, if someone came to you right now and said, when you go home, yeah, your father want to talk to you. All of us, even me, I'm 36, right, with two kids. Like, man. Start sweating. Imagine, or your mother want to talk to you, or your roommate. Someone calls you and says, I need to speak to you now. We get nervous, right? We call them back, what's going on? Start text messaging. Something happened, like, no, I just want to see if we can go for dinner. Why? Because the fear of standing in front of someone and being responsible makes that khawf, that fear. So imagine, يوم يقوم الناس لرب العالمين, when people are going to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we are asked about our youth and our lives and how we used our life. That fear that we feel, that auditing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is a tough oddity. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, watch in Surah Al-Qaf what happens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about His true servants, those who know Him. He says, مَنْ خَشْيَ الرَّحْمَانَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَجَاءَ بِقَلْبٍ مُنِيبٍ. Ya salam. Allah says, who fears Ar-Rahman? What does Ar-Rahman mean? The most merciful. How can you fear the most merciful? Allah says, مَنْ خَشْيَ الرَّحْمَانَ. Who fears Ar-Rahman? Imam Ibn Ashur Al-Maliki, rahimahullah. Today we only mention Malikis. Yeah. Imam Ibn Ashur Al-Maliki, rahimahullah. He said something nice. He said something very beautiful. He said they fear him. They fear him. But because they know him, they know that the essence of all of Allah's attributes is mercy. So even though they fear him, and they have that, you know, that strong connection to him, feeling responsible to him, but they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as related by Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu, that the Prophet said, Allah said, سَبَقَتْ رَحْمَتِي غَدَبِي أو كَمَا قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَمْ, that Allah said, my mercy come before my anger, my wrath. And that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that Allah's mercy in a sound hadith is divided into 100 parts. Only one part in this dunya, the other 99 in the hereafter. And he said, تِبَاقُ مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. He said, that one part of mercy of Allah can fill everything in the heavens and the earth. The whole universe. خلاص, forget about the Hubble, man. بعد الهبل كمان. After the Hubble, رحمة الله. So he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, that's why you see the animal, she will lift her foot for her offspring. Another hadith of the Prophet, which is a sound hadith, the woman who lost her baby, her infant, in the battlefield. One time I lost my daughter in this IKEA store. I start crying. Wallahi, as soon as I lost her, I start crying. She was only two. Shifa. Ya salam. Fain shifa di. Then I start to look for her. I can't find her. I start crying. Subhanallah. Can you imagine on the Day of Judgment, even you won't know your parents, or your parents won't know you, man. La ilaha illallah. يفروا من أخي. You will actually run from your brother and run وأمه وأبي. Except who? الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين. Except the people of piety, they'll be together. You'll be with your parents. You'll be with your brothers. You get a little jama'at working. Piety set. But those people who have issues, they're not going to know it. I don't know who you are, man. I'm your son. I don't know you. So I lost my daughter in the store. I start fleeing, running around. And then I remember she likes these balls. So I ran and I found her, alhamdulillah. She was playing with those balls. And then she doesn't understand. Why are you crying? I'm playing with balls. But the Prophet said, and this is serious, he said about that woman, he said, do you think that she can throw her because she found her child? You can imagine, if you lost your child in, what's it, IKEA? You lost your child there. I live in Egypt, I don't know, we have Khan Khalili. You lost your child over there. You can imagine how you'll feel if you lost your child in the battlefield. Yes, salam. So she was running, then she found her baby, then she began to suckle this baby. Then the Prophet ﷺ said to his companions, do you think she can throw this baby in the fire? They said, لا والله يا رسول الله. Said, no. Then he said, الله أرحم من هذه, الله أرحم بعباده من هذه بولديها. Yes, salam. He said, Allah is more merciful to his servant than this woman to this baby.